The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 13779 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to business. Any member who wishes to speak to the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that Motion 13779 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one, I call Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the delivery of MV Glensannox and MV Glenrosa in light of reports that a senior programme director has been removed from the project.
Deputy First Minister.
The Scottish Government was informed on the 19th of June by Ferguson Marine that the ship delivery director's contract had been terminated as a result of a breakdown in trust. This is wholly a decision for Ferguson Marine. I can, however, confirm that the interim chief executive officer of Ferguson Marine provided his most recent update on MV Glensannox in a letter to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee on the 31st of May 2024. And in that letter, he states that the yard is working to achieve the handover date of the 31st of July 2024.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that? A breakdown in trust is an interesting phrase. I think there's been an awful lot of trust broken between our island communities and this government, unfortunately. And I would say that this latest loss of expertise right at the very top of the yard comes just 3 months after Ferguson's well-respected chief executive was unceremoniously sacked from his position as well. What are these relationships that are breaking down within the yard? And they're helping nobody, no least the workers in the yard themselves. Now, David Tymon was apparently sacked on the grounds of poor performance. But I think everybody knows the truth. He was more likely that he was sacked from his position because he was simply speaking uncomfortable truth to power about this whole sorry saga. And I think what our islanders and the yard workers at Fergus Marine deserve is some straight-talking truth from ministers, not bad news that's going to be snuck out after recess. Let me ask specifically, if it wasn't clear the first time round, will the MV Glensannox be delivered to Seamill by the end of July, yes or no?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, in the last few weeks, I have met with the Chair and the Chief Executive. I have made it very clear to them my expectations, and both of them have confirmed to me that they see no change to the commitment to delivering by the end of July. Obviously, when it comes to the Chief Executive, he will continue to keep the Net Zero Committee informed, but certainly face-to-face in those conversations and publicly in the written letters that he has issued to the relevant committee, he has made clear the commitment to meet the 31st of July deadline.
Jamie Green.
I'm sorry to say to the Cabinet Secretary, but knowing this topical question was coming up in the Chamber today, wouldn't you have picked the phone up and spoken to the Chief Executive and got an update today? What's the status on the ships today? Not in a letter from weeks ago. Because it's not good enough, starting off, it's not good enough for our island communities. These vessels are nearly 6 years late. They're approaching £500 million in cost, and it's still rising. And all the while, the yard itself has no certainty over its long-term future. The phrase being used by workers themselves at the yard is that time is running out. They are absolutely right. Time is running out for the yard. So let me also ask, when will this government make a decision on the small vessel replacement programme? And secondly, when on earth is this government finally going to get a grip of the endless disruption that our islands face as a result of this whole sorry saga?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the member will know that I said just a matter of days into office that we expected that decision to be announced imminently. A few days later, his boss, the Prime Minister, called an election, and we have been tied up with Purdah, unable to make public announcements. So we would hope to be in a position to make a public announcement as soon as we are permitted to do so.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's important to remember that the key reason that the Scottish Government stepped in to save Ferguson Marine was to protect the jobs in the area of high deprivation and also unemployment. But can the Cabinet Secretary detail how many people have been employed since then? How have local businesses also benefited? And how many young people have secured apprentices at the yard?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, Stuart McMillan has been a long-standing advocate for the yard and for the local community, both of which are a priority to the government. There are 288 staff currently employed at the shipyard. Since the shipyard became publicly owned, 72 apprentices have been employed, with two-thirds of those remaining with the yard having completed their apprenticeships. Recently, one of the yard's young female apprentices won the Scottish Engineering Graduate Apprentice of the Year Award, which is a fantastic achievement that highlights the commitment of the business to develop future talent.
Katie Clark.
The Deputy First Minister will be aware of the anger and distress on Arran and other islands given the delays and unreliability of the ferry service. But workers at Ferguson Marine are also in a similar position. Last year, the then Chief Executive Officer of Ferguson Marine warned that urgent investment was needed by last Christmas to enable essential reconfiguration at the site. We are very aware that the Deputy First Minister took part in a summit, but can she give an update, given this investment is both urgent and essential?
Well, there's a lot in Katie Clark's question, from islanders to future investment, including workers at the yard. Let me take them one at a time. First of all, we recognise the impact on Arran residents. The Cabinet Secretary for Transport has stressed to CalMac that everything must be done to address capacity and to provide assurances for the community as we approach the peak summer season. On to the request for investment then at the yard. We have been progressing work on that. When I met with the unions at the beginning of May, we said that the outcome of that due diligence work was a matter of days. That was true at the time. I'm very keen to be in a position to publicly announce what we will be able to do next, and look forward to being out of Purdah in order to do that. Thank you.
Willie Rennie.
The Deputy First Minister talks about trust, but she seems to be trusting the board and the chief executive an awful lot in this circumstance. These are the people that got rid of the two widely respected individuals who were brought in to rescue the project when it fell apart some years ago. So how does the Deputy First Minister have that confidence? What steps has she taken to get the expertise from outside government and beyond to know that these are the right steps? Especially as Mr Crossman has returned to CMAL. He's not discredited. He's still got his job. So why has this happened? And what is she going to do about it?
Deputy First Minister.
A number of different points. In terms of getting the expertise, we have taken steps to ensure that we have as much of the expertise as possible when it comes to informing our decision. For example, in my answer to Katie Clark, talking about getting the right due diligence on the investment work that is required. CMAL have indicated that they will continue to lend full support to FMPG to deliver the MV Glensannex. They will utilise other members of the technical team where appropriate, because we are all committed to delivering the Glensannex according to schedule.
Keen to take further members, but I'm grateful if questions were concise. Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I was in Arran on Sunday and there are real concerns about vessel capacity. Arran is struggling with the capacity constraints caused by repairs to the MV Caledonian Isles taking out of service. Can the Cabinet Secretary give an update on ongoing work to urgently bring that vessel back into service? And with Arran Farmers Show and Brodick Highland Games taking place in early August, how will CalMac ensure the island has adequate capacity as summer progresses?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the member is right to raise this. We do see the significant impact on Arran residents, communities and businesses of the reduced ferry capacity to Arran following the outage of the MV Caledonian Isles for essential steelwork repairs. In discussion with the Cabinet Secretary for Transport, she has been communicating with CalMac to try and get everything done as quickly as possible to address capacity and provide assurances. She is getting regular updates on when the vessel will return to service, and we understand from CalMac that this is currently expected in August. Interim arrangements are in place currently to help with capacity, with MV Alfred operating on the Arran route and additional crew being available to maximise the vessel's passenger capacity throughout this period.
Graham Simpson.
Thank you. What led to this breakdown in trust between the board and the programme director?
First Minister.
Well, this was entirely a decision that was taken by Ferguson Marine and the board of Ferguson Marine. In terms of moving forward, CMAL have committed to continue to work with Ferguson Marine to ensure that both vessels are delivered as quickly as possible. And this was a decision taken by the board, it would be appropriate for them to speak to the situation and not for Scottish ministers.
Brief supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Is it not the case that this chairman, who has no shipbuilding experience, is repeatedly sacking those who do for telling him uncomfortable truths about the operational realities of delivering a highly complex programme that is actually on track for handover, as it always has been for months, this summer? That has not changed. All that has changed is that the chairman seems to be taking out a face-saving exercise on the operational workforce who are leading this project as best they can.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I have confidence in the chair of Ferguson Marine, and I have confidence in the Chief Executive to deliver the work that has been set out. Having met with them very recently, both of them individually, as well as the Chief Financial Officer, I have made it clear what my expectations are, and they have provided me with assurances. But as you know, the Chief Executive is also ensuring that he is under scrutiny of Parliament and is answerable to the Scottish Parliament Committee, and he will provide his next quarterly update to that committee.
Question number two, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported public safety and environmental concerns arising from the fire at Linwood Industrial Estate on 23rd June.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to thank the Scottish Fire Rescue Service crews, along with all our emergency services, for their sterling efforts in tackling the large and complex fire that broke out at the Inver Recycling Scotland facility on Sunday. At its height, 10 appliances and 50 firefighters were at the scene. Thankfully, there were no casualties. And as of this morning, SFRS have confirmed there is currently one fire appliance and one height appliance remain in attendance, with firefighters working to eliminate any remaining hotspots and dampen down. As a precaution, early yesterday morning, local residents were advised to remain indoors with windows and doors shut. That advice was lifted later yesterday morning. As part of a multi-agency response, the Scottish Environment Protection Agency is actively engaged in the situation and working closely with public sector partners, including Public Health Scotland and Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board, to mitigate any potential impact on the surrounding community and environment. And I'm pleased to say there is currently no ongoing risk to public safety, and the cause of the fire will be subject of an immediate and thorough investigation, as would normally happen.
Hugh Bibby.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I join with the Minister in extending my thanks to the 50 firefighters who attended for their bravery and professionalism in tackling this fire, and also to the police, SEPA and council officials who have also responded. The scale of the fire at the waste recycling plant was significant. It could be seen for many miles across Renfrewshire, Glasgow and beyond. There has also been significant concern over its environmental impact. Local residents, as the Minister mentioned, were urged to close their windows and doors to avoid toxic smoke. Debris and ash have been reported in landing in people's properties many miles away. So what advice has or will it be given on what people should do if they have battery or any other debris from the fire, for example, in their gardens or on their cars?
Minister.
Thank you, Neil Bibby, for that question. SEPA has confirmed that there was no compliance issues around this site that they were aware of, and the site was deemed low risk with no impact on amenity, and have confirmed it is well managed and only deals with waste electronic electrical equipment. For any constituents of that area that do have any residue from this in their gardens, I would be contacting the local authority. I know SEPA do have a working group, and they will be liaising with the local authority as well and SFRS.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Minister for that reply, and I would hope that the authorities would also publicly make available that advice rather than just asking constituents to seek it. I think that would be helpful. The recycling of electric batteries is only going to become more and more prevalent, and we have already seen another fire at the industrial estate in 2022. Working with the industry, will the Minister ask the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and SEPA to publish a full report on not just what happened, but what the risks were, what they could be in the future, and what mitigations can be put in place in order to maintain public confidence in the future?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think we have to wait for the thorough investigation to be concluded before we decide what make any commitments towards that. But just for the member's information, he might like to be made aware, along with other the UK nations, the Scottish Government is currently reviewing the UK-wide batteries regulation that apply to both to placing on the market and waste battery issues, including recycling. We're considering the changes needed to provide an appropriate framework for the increasing number of EV batteries arising as waste, and how these can be best managed within the UK market. And this will include looking at opportunities for better regulation.
We can have concise questions and responses. I can take a few more members. Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I also would like to thank the Emergency Services for their response. Scottish Fire and Rescue presented to the cross-party group on accident prevention and safety awareness on so-called zombie batteries. And while investigations I know are ongoing in this situation, lithium-ion batteries must be appropriately disposed of and contained as they are recycled. But consumer action is absolutely vital in this. So what action could the Scottish Government take to raise consumer awareness of the safe and appropriate disposal of rechargeable batteries, in particular in goods such as vapes, toothbrushes and USB charge devices?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SFRS also has, the member might be aware, a bespoke working group in place which focuses on the risks of lithium-ion batteries, and their findings will bolster our community safety messaging. This working group has been expanded to include a number of stakeholders and to assist in a number of work streams, including the planning and consultation process for battery energy storage systems, which I would hope, in conclusion, would raise awareness within the public community.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me also thank the Fire Service for their efforts, and fortunately no one was hurt. Whilst the exact cause of the fire is yet to be established, we have to recognise waste facilities, especially battery recycling facilities, are at a risk of incidents, which is why I've repeatedly raised safety concerns such as around handling lithium batteries and gas canisters. The Scottish Government told me back in 2022 discussions were ongoing with the waste sector. So can the Minister tell us what action has been taken since then?
Minister.
Thank you. As I've said previously, there is a bespoke working group that is in place, as well as the UK Government is currently reviewing the UK-wide batteries regulation. The Scottish Government is clear that battery energy storage is an essential component of decarbonised electricity grid, and we need bold action to tackle the climate emergency, and Scotland has extensive renewable generation capabilities with which to accelerate our just transition to net zero.
Mark Crossgall.
Signing Officer, the scenes that we saw were absolutely horrific, and I also pay tribute to emergency services. We never want to see these scenes again, but we have seen repeated fires such as this across Scotland, particularly at Fryerton in Perth, which led to a tragic loss of life. Would the Minister agree with me that we do need those who manufacture and sell disposable electronic devices to take more producer responsibility for their products, including take-back schemes where they can invest in proper health and safety requirements that will keep them safe, but also keep these products recycled?
Minister.
Thank you. Yes, and I share the members' concerns. I know since 2023 there have been 1,200 fires across the UK, and it's an increase of 71% from 2022. And as the member said, we had have four fires like this in Scotland. And yes, I'm in agreement with the member.
Brief supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I would join in offering thanks to all of the emergency services who attended this fire. As we've heard already, the plume of smoke could be seen from some miles away and indeed drifted several miles northwards. There was some concern raised with me locally that it did take several hours for public health information to be forthcoming, for people to close their windows and stay indoors. And obviously there was a sense of fear and alarm in the surrounding area. So can I ask the Minister what learning will be done with civil contingency partners to understand just how events unfolded that evening? And how will she ensure that local residents are kept informed of the investigations going forward?
Minister.
Neil Bibby earlier on, that we will ensure that there is consultation and information out in the public domain, and I think lessons can be learnt. I know that there was a working group set up immediately with SEPA, our local health service, and also SFRS, and we will continue to engage and also let the community know what's happening.